Welcome to today's webinar presented by the College Music Society, the sixth and last in our Musicians' Health series for this academic year. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to MC today's presentation by Isabel Artigues, entitled Risk Factors, Signs of Injury and Prevention in the Performing Arts. Isabel Artigues is a pioneering physiotherapist, pole star Pilates instructor with a Master of Science degree in Performing Arts Medicine. She combines diverse clinical experiences and published research with regular lecturing at colleges and universities in the UK, notably University College London and Trinity Laban Conservatoire of Music and Dance, and in Spain at the Institute of the Arts, Barcelona. She leads the Young Professionals Resource Database Committee at PAMA, which is the Performing Arts Medicine Association, and the Research Committee at AMPAE, the Spanish Multidisciplinary Association for the Performing Arts. She's now based in Philadelphia here in the States. I see that we have over 40 colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Today, I'm broadcasting from Boone, North Carolina, and Ms. Artigues is in Philadelphia. We are also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. Isabel, welcome to this CMS webinar.
Thank you so much, everybody. It's a pleasure to meet you all. So yes, my name is Isabel and I'll be talking today about risk factors, signs of injury and prevention in the performing arts. I'm gonna be sharing my screen. I've got some slides. Beautiful. So, a little bit about myself. I am a former flute player. I played up to grade 8, which is right before college in Spain. And during my time at the conservatoire, I noticed that there were some pain and discomfort was pretty common amongst my classmates and myself. And so my journey in performing arts medicine began, and I trained as a physiotherapist to work with musicians and dancers and performers in general. After my degree, I moved to London in 2011 to be part of the first cohort of the Masters in Performing Arts Medicine that the University College London and the British Association for Performing Arts Medicine had put together. And through my experience in London, I was able to work as a physical therapist on site, the Conservatoire, Trinity Laban Conservatoire of Music and Dance, and treating the students in their music and dance faculty. That inspired me to go back home in Barcelona and establish an on-site health clinic as well inside the Institute of Arts Barcelona, where I lead a multidisciplinary team to take care of their staff and students. And throughout my career, I was able to publish 2 articles based on my dissertation of my master's. And I've been pretty active in research ever since, presenting at international conferences like at PAMA, IADAMS, and ASPA in Australia. And most recently, I was able to get back into the University College London faculty as a module lead in their master's degree. So that's about me. Today, we'll be looking at the risk factors and main causes of injury in musicians. We'll look at the concept of posture and axial elongation and why that's important. We'll look at the anatomy of the spine and the concept of kinetic chain and understand how injuries can come actually from playing and increase the difference, the awareness of how individual differences and the musical interface can also affect our performance as musicians. So first of all, I'd like to reflect a little bit with the people that are joining us today live. So if you wouldn't mind sharing with me on the chat, if you have any ideas or thoughts on how would we define or describe a music-related injury, how do you think common symptoms might be? You may have experienced some yourselves, and what common areas of pain and injury we find in musicians, And what causes you think might be contributing to those injuries? If you wouldn't mind putting something on the chat, it can help us get the conversation going. And at any point, if you have questions, please feel free to write them on the chat too. Yeah, repetitive motions. Yeah, we're going to look at that. Tingling numbness. Yes, I love it. Some people, like Campbell was talking about the causes. Jacqueline is going at it with the signs and symptoms. And Aaron is giving us the common areas. Perfect. Yes, you guys are all correct.
Yeah, Isabel, just so you know that there, I believe the chat may only be visible to the to you and me. So
if really?
If there are things you want to read back to them, yeah. I
think yes, that's possible. Yeah. That works. So Campbell was talking about repetitive motions can cause problems. Jacqueline was talking about tingling, numbness, tension, and tightness can be signs of injury. Aaron saying back, hands, wrist, arm, hips. Neck, shoulders, upper back. Jacqueline is talking about areas, common areas of pain, lower back, neck pain, finger numbness, upper back, shoulder pain could be an area of injury. Yes, you are all on the ball. Holding an asymmetrical instrument for extended periods. Carolyn, you got it. Perfect. So as you guys guessed, musicians do have a high level of musculoskeletal injuries. Mainly from an overuse nature, and they are mainly in the spine and upper limb. So hand and wrist, forearm and elbow, shoulder, upper back, lower back, neck, but also hearing, TMJ, so the jaw joint, and mental health are also pretty common. Signs and symptoms, as you were mentioning as well, can encompass discomfort, aches, soreness, tenderness, more nervous sensations like pins and needles, numbness, tingling, a sense of fatigue or heaviness, weakness or loss of strength, postural changes and compensations, muscle imbalances, local swelling if it's more of an acute situation, impaired dexterity. When we go into a little bit more of a neurological disorder, and simply pain. I believe we also have some singers with us today. So singers will experience obviously signs more related with the voice, although they may also experience musculoskeletal signs and symptoms. Some signs for singers might be lack of power or changes in quality of the pitch and the volume. Loss of range, changes in the speaking voice, hoarseness, continuous clearing of the throat, heartburn, or register breaks. And those signs might, you know, appear and might resolve, but if they stay on for a number of weeks, then we might be finding ourselves in a presence of injury. So when looking at risk factors, we define them amongst three columns here. Environmental aspects encompass anything to do with the environment we are playing on. So the temperature, the lining, the surface, the layout of the stage, but also the instrument interface would fall on this category. So that is an object we are interacting with. So imagine it would be like a prop in dance. The second column is the physical demands. So as some of you were mentioning, the physical demands will be the postures that the instrument makes us put ourselves into, sometimes pretty awkward postures, the amount of repetition that the piece might require, the duration of that activity, the intensity. If, for example, we're talking about brass players, the vibration that's happening, or you know, string players, and essentially the physical demands of the activity at hand. And on the right column, we have the personal characteristics. So this is our age, our gender, and if we've got diabetes, and our nutrition practices, our posture, our mental state, all those would fall under the personal category. And of course, musculoskeletal injury is multifactorial most of the times. So we will have an alignment of planets from all of those three columns that will come and create a situation for an injury to occur. We defined injury as a physical condition that affects the ability of an individual to perform. So it is a physical injury we're talking about. As we can see, posture gets referenced throughout the columns of the risk factors. So that is why we are going to focus today on posture. So what is posture? Posture is, we define posture as the position in which someone holds their body when standing or sitting. When we are talking about posture, we want to find this neutrality of the skeleton so that the pelvis, the ribcage, the spine, the skull, they all are falling in this like plumb line, we call it, which is this red line that you can see across the body. And when our spine is in neutral, that's when we find our optimal posture, which is a position where the body is going to have the greatest efficiency and the greatest degrees in motion in all planes. So that's flexion, extension, side bending, rotation. When we start losing this axial elongation, and for example, imagine gravity compresses us down, right? So creates compression. So axial elongation tries to fight against this gravity. If you think about bringing all of the structures of the body together, then that would create that axial length up. And so that's where the concept of core stability also comes from. So creating that compression from the muscles and the structures of the body so that we can fight gravity and like find that axial length across the plumb line. And obviously optimal posture then creates maximum efficiency for our body to start moving from. And it's when our deep muscles and the core can work most efficiently as well. So if we think about compressing the arms down and then lifting up the arms, right? And then sitting nice and tall and lifting up the arms, we can see how we gain more range just by the fact that we are placing the spine in a more neutral state. Yes. So in the spine, how we, when we see the spine from the front, it looks straight. But when we look at it from the side, we see four curvatures that essentially like create two kyphotic and two lordotic curvatures that you can see here. So the cervical spine and the lumbar spine are lordotic, so they go away from towards the plumb line, and the thoracic spine and the sacrum and the coccyx have a kyphotic, so it's going away from the plumb line. The different curvatures on the spine have different functions. So the cervical spine, for example, has an emphasis on mobility. We don't have many other structures that attach to it. So we can move in all planes and all degrees of motion. The thoracic spine instead is, its main focus is protection of the most vital organs, which are the lungs and the heart. And that's where the ribcage come in. And that ribcage then really restricts the motion at the thoracic spine. The lumbar spine, its main function is weight bearing. So the vertebrae get much, much bigger as they go down on the spine. And it doesn't have many bony structures either. So a lot of like the support of the lower back comes from dynamic structures like the muscles and the fascia. And that's why, again, core stability and core control is important, because that curvature of the spine will only be controlled by dynamic muscles. And lastly, we have the sacrum and the coccyx, which constitute the pelvis together with the ilium bones. And that the pelvis is integral for any single leg standing or walking or standing, sitting, any weight-bearing activities. How the spine is structured in these four curvatures allow us to be a bipedal animal. And being a bipedal animal allows us to have more dexterity on our fingers, because they have been liberated from any weight-bearing functions. So that's why it allows us to have these amazing musicians that are able to have this great dexterity in their hands. And if we, and we can see how if we lose function by compromising the neutrality of these curves, then we are going to potentially affect the function and the dexterity of the hands. Please let me know if there's any questions. I'm gonna keep the chat open. Great. So this was in standing, right? So when we are sitting, we can see then how it's really important that the pelvis is in a neutral place, so that then the spine can be also neutral from there, yeah? So for example, if you try to sit, right? And sit with the pelvis slouched back, you'll see how it's very difficult to lift up from there. It takes effort. Versus if we're sitting in a neutral pelvis and we're sitting on our seat bones, then the spine can organically organize itself so that the spine is maintaining those curvatures and we have more efficiency. It takes less effort for us to maintain upright. Cool. Then on top of that, we have, wait, there's a Q&A. Okay, perfect. Sorry, I was just taking care of this. Okay. So essentially, sorry, I'm just like trying to close this, sorry. So there's some muscles in that attach to the pelvis, like the hamstrings and the psoas muscle. And any tightness on those muscles can contribute to the inability of that pelvis to maintain neutral. So for example, it may have happened to some of you, or you may have seen some students that when we sit on the floor, then they are not able to maintain the pelvis in neutral and their pelvis kind of tilts forward. So that means that the hamstrings muscles underneath are very tight and they are pulling from the pelvis, so that pelvis cannot maintain neutral, which then will affect the lower back and the thoracic spine, et cetera, et cetera. So that's why it's important to have flexibility on the pelvis. And I always say that everybody should be able to like touch their toes or be very close to it, so that we can have flexibility and mobility on that pelvis and allow for the spine then to organize without having pulls from the muscles, tightness around the hips, yeah? And since we are sitting so much these days, it's important that we are able to kind of undo some of the tightness that gets built up from long sitting. Aaron is asking, does it matter if you need to bend your knees to touch your toes? So it does matter, because you are like shortening the structure to touch it, right? So it will, this essentially is saying that like these are the hamstrings are the ones that are tight, right? So the ones, it won't matter in if you are sitting, because you will be able to potentially still have neutral spine when you are sitting and your knees are bent. But then imagine you are in a standing situation, and depending what instrument you play, you may not be in a standing situation ever. But there are some instruments that have the ability to play in standing or in sitting. So when you're in standing, then your knees are going to be straight, and then you're going to feel the pull. So it's important that that you are able to maybe work on that flexibility and be able to like gain a little bit more mobility in the pelvis and the hips, because that will then allow the spine to have more freedom of movement and achieve more efficiency. That makes sense. How can I work on being able to touch my toes without bending my knees? That is the key. We'll go over some of the exercises and practices that I recommend for this later on the lecture. So essentially, it makes sense that some of the muscles being tight will affect the positioning of the pelvis if those muscles are tight. So we call the kinetic chain. So kinetic means force, and chain means a system that's connected together. So the body has muscles and bones and ligaments, etc. And then there's a fascia system that connects all of those muscles and creates chains. So for example, we have like an oblique chain, we have a frontal chain, a back chain. And if you imagine, for example, a golfer or a baseball player, and how they go from, they engage the lower limb and then they give a component of rotation of the trunk, and then they get all the force so that then the arm can have full power. And that is the most efficient of finding power through the kinetic chain. If they were to just throw it as an overhead and use only the power from the shoulder, they would not be able to get as far, right? So the kinetic chain allows us to find even more power using a whole chain of muscles connected together through the fascia system. So for example, if we apply this to musicians, we can see how, for example, going for like from Aaron's example that they were mentioning, if we have our pelvis sitting a little bit more forward than the plumb line would be, for example, in standing, then that can create a chain of events happening up the spine and into the neck, and therefore will affect the arm function and the dexterity. Yeah. So in this position, for example, having active legs, it's very important, even in sitting, having that power from the legs and those big muscles on the legs is very important. Then the trunk needs to be as neutral as possible, understanding some of those neutralities will be affected by the instrument itself. The shoulder joint then has to anchor the upper arm in space. The elbow will allow for arm length adjustment. The forearm will rotate the wrist. The wrist will allow for hand positioning. And then this will free up the fingers to do the magic. Great. So when we look at musicians in at injuries in musicians, sometimes, you know, we are all human beings and we can have injuries that anyone could have, and they are just happening in musicians. But sometimes we can have injuries that stem from music playing. And those are the ones that are important for us to understand so that we can prevent, because then this means that our art form is causing injuries, and that is, you know, not a good prospect for us to get into it, right? So it's important that we are able to prevent those. A lot of these injuries stem again from posture related disorders. So having symmetric versus asymmetric playing postures, playing in sitting versus standing, essentially the physical demands of that activity, we really need to understand it so that then we can understand which areas of the body are going to need to be warmed up so that we can do a proper warm up of the body as well as the instrument, and make sure that those areas are gonna be ready to go and to cope with the load and that that the music playing is going to give them. So for example, again, if you can put on the chat, for each picture, and you can take pictures that are not in here. So, you know, you can give examples of other instruments. But for example, think of a sitting, an instrument that requires sitting posture, and an instrument that requires sitting and standing posture. And ideally, the posture shouldn't really change if they are sitting or if they are standing, correct? So try to think of instruments that are maybe in your domain that that have this requirement of sitting versus standing. The instrument handling, is it pretty awkward to get to, or is it pretty symmetrical? Like a piano, it's pretty symmetrical. A flute is very asymmetrical. And think of the demands of that. The weight of the instrument, is it the same to hold a violin than to hold a trombone, right? The difference in weights, how this can make an impact. The degrees of arm elevation, we know that sustained arm elevation, it's a lot more fatiguing than below 90 degrees. So instruments like flute that are constant in arm elevation are a lot more fatiguing than piano, for example, which is like below 90 degrees. The movement repetition that's required on the instrument. So are there muscles and are there body parts that are supposed to be in static contraction versus dynamic contraction, right? So again, in piano, maybe we're able to like move the whole arm, so it's pretty free, but we find ourselves in a violin position, or again in a flute position, and the arms need to be staying in one position and then only move the fingers, right, to hold the instrument. So those things are also pretty important to take into account. And then do we have other systems that are part of it? For example, is breathing part of the instrument playing as well? Now, I would argue that even string instruments and pianists need to use breathing as part of their practice, but that system is not, how you call it? There's brass and wind instruments that will require to have also an added strain on their breathing system, right? Or control. Sometimes it can be a good thing because it forces them to use that system for efficiency, but it can also create a strain, right? So just things to take into account. Yes, Bridget says, surely breathing is essential for all, even if it's not for the tone production. Agreed, absolutely. So when looking at your musicians or at yourself and preparing to practice music, think about these components of music playing, the sitting posture or the standing posture, the pelvis position, the instrument handling, the degrees of arm elevation, the asymmetry of it all, the amount of repetition, and try to shape your warm-up to meet the demands of that task. Cool. So essentially, as we were just saying, instrumentalists often find themselves holding an asymmetric posture for quite a long time. And on top of that, then we have gravity, which forces us down, compresses down, and also the weight of the instrument on an already asymmetric load, that can create quite a lot of fatigue if this is sustained for a very long time. So that's why it's important that as much as possible within the constraints of the interface that we are working with, which is the instrument, we try to find the most neutrality of the spine and of the skeleton as possible. But we all have like an inner posture going back to the right column of the risk factors, right? So we were working a lot on the middle one and the physical demands, but we all will have like biases on our postures. For example, if we're crossing legs when we're sitting, or if we are putting weight on one leg when we're standing, those will create biases and asymmetries on our body that will already be there by the time we then go and play the instrument. So it's also important for us to be aware of what intricacies we are bringing to the table as well, and be able to address those ones ahead of time. And on top of that, there's a very high prevalence in musicians of hypermobility, which is excessive joint laxity, particularly in the fingers. And so some of these musicians will really have struggles to even like be able to maintain neutral hand position while holding their instruments. So this is some of the examples, and you may have come across this in your practice, but it's important that like we're able to address those joints early on, because those hyperextensions create breakages in the chain. And so therefore the muscles are not able, and the kinetic chain is not able to work in its most efficiency. And so then we get a lot of fatigue and muscle pain in those musicians. And of course we already mentioned the interface, but it's important that we are always having into account the size, the shape, the weight of this instrument, and then who we are putting this instrument on, what age, what their capabilities are in terms of being able to tolerate the load that the instrument is going to create on it. And maybe we build up the practice to make it a sustainable and healthy practice. Just finishing up here, understanding that posture and alignment, it's only one part of the puzzle on an optimal health of the body. We need to have healthy tissues to work with. So hydration, good nutrition, rest and sleep, management of stress, they are all important so that our tissues have the flexibility to take on the demands of our daily life practice and music playing being part of it. And then due to the physicality of playing music as well, it's important that musicians also work on their strength, flexibility, and endurance so that they can go not only from a place of optimal alignment bony structures wise or skeleton wise and posture, but also be able to go into that performance phase where they are also strong, and their ability then to maintain that alignment will be sustained with time. With that in mind, there are a bunch of practices called somatic practices. Some of the examples are here on the right, Pilates, Alexander Technique, yoga, that can help raise this awareness on where our body is and optimal alignment. They can help us improve our posture and be aware of our posture. They all encourage easeful and mindful motion. And in general, they promote a balance and an equilibrium in the body, and can help us really to have this check-in with ourselves and be able to learn and listen to how the body's feeling and be able to feel those signs of injury very early on. And so I really recommend those practices to be part of, you know, either a music college experience or an extracurricular experience, so that they can really find that awareness that comes with moving that sometimes musicians are not exposed to. I work a lot with dancers, and their body awareness, just because the fact that they are working with their bodies all the time, is always like so much bigger than in musicians. And so I wonder how much better we could get at our injury prevention if we were teaching efficient and mindful movement to musicians. So this is what I recommend in order to start raising awareness amongst our students on this. And so in conclusion, wait, we have a question on Ethel. I'll respond to this question after this last slide. So in conclusion, musculoskeletal injuries are common. We find them across many stages in a musician's career. And so prevention practices are important, and understanding of signs and symptoms is key, so we can have early detection of those. Axial elongation and posture, so optimal body positioning of the body, can help us increase the movement and the performance, the efficiency of the performance. And music playing itself can affect the posture, and the posture can be affected and can affect then music playing. So it's important that we have a constant check-in about how the body is coping with the music practice. And finally, for college music teachers, it's to understand those risk factors, how they play and how they get applied in real life, and this anatomy of like how the body works, so that we're able to promote more efficient and effective training. We can reduce the risk of overtraining and muscle imbalances and injury in general, help us achieve this peak performance and success that we're all working towards, and potentiate a longevity of a musician's career. So these are some references, and thank you very much for your time. Ethel had a question. What about carrying the instrument in its case? Some cases can be rolled, some carried on the back, over the shoulder. Yes, this is a really good question, Ethel. It all depends on the weight that we're talking about, and again, how often it's happening. So there's always like, fatigue is a concept that it's variable and it's reversible, right? So we are always working with the intensity, the frequency, and the length of time, right? So if you're able to play with these factors, then you'll be able to manage how the body copes with it a lot more. If we are talking about a violin, then it can certainly be done as a backpack, maybe making sure that it's symmetrically carried on the back instead of on one shoulder. So in terms of posture and efficiency of the body, symmetrical loads are always better than asymmetrical loads. And I'm sure that we can all relate to that, that we've like found ourselves with like an extra, you know, we wanted to only have one bag of groceries instead of two bags. And then we're like carrying it around, and we end up with like, you know, having, just feeling like not compensated. So I think that those things are important to take into account. Jacqueline, are you familiar with the book Atonal? I've not read this book, Jacqueline, but I'll look it up for sure. I'm not sure what it, but I like the title, that's for sure. Exercises for to improve the performance of the musician.
Isabel, you know, thanks so much. This has been so good. And I've got a question. Conversation about symmetry and asymmetry in terms mm-hmm. of instrumental performance, I may have missed it in your conversation, but are there for someone, say, you know, I saw my colleague who I know is a bassoonist write the question about asymmetry with an instrument. Are there, you know, if you're playing the bassoon, you have your hands in exactly the or relatively the same position and same relative position all the time. Mm-hmm. As opposed to a lot of exercises where you alternate, right? So, in typical exercise, you try to balance things. If you're doing something with your left hand, you then try to do it with your right hand and the like. But you can't do that as an instrumentalist. Are there exercises that are people recommend to help create balance with that? Or is it really about learning how to simply compensate within the process of that asymmetry?
Yeah, so that is one of the important things to understand about the task, right, that we are doing. And the task, right, and when you go into professional world, our job, right, it's asymmetric, and we'll put an asymmetrical load on our body all the time, constantly. If it's a concert season, it's going to be more. If it's, having an off season and we can't manage and have more control on the practice, then we can manage that load. But it will be something that, like, the job that's have these requirements. For some people, it's like sound levels, and for musicians as well, that too. But in terms of posture, that is the requirement of performing that task. So we just have to make sure that we are preparing the body as best as possible to cope with that load. So understanding we need a baseline strength of the body in order to be able to cope with the load. And then our warm up needs to make sure that it's checking in with those areas that will be asked a little bit extra. And our cool down needs to make sure that we are doing the stretches to provide to kind of almost like undo some of the asymmetry with the stretches at the end of practice, right? And then have this cross training that will promote symmetry, with some of the somatic practices that I was talking about. But there's also, like weight training is also an option, you know what I mean? Like having cross training practices that will help create symmetry within the body. And so that the body is resilient once we are putting those asymmetric loads on.
Wow, that really really makes so much sense. You're mentioning weight training. I'm old enough to remember a time. I think it was probably 40 years ago where there was mentioned by someone that weight training and abdominal exercises were bad for performers. And I think because there was a sense that if you, of course, if you abuse that exercise, you can create rigidity. And rigidity or over muscularize, but most people that doesn't happen. It's pretty, anyone who's lifted weights and wanted to gain muscle mass knows how hard that is. But to gain basic balance and flexibility and strength, we've learned that that's a pretty immediate benefit. So I wonder if you've had have other thoughts about the revisionist view, current views that counter what we used to think about these issues of performance connected to our physicality and anatomy. Are there other things that we've debunked recently? Can you think? I'm just curious if that's the case.
Well, particularly, like, so in my research, for example, in my research, I worked in hypermobile finger joints of flutists, for example, and I was looking at, some structures that you can put on the instrument in order to make them more ergonomic. And this is one biggie one because some instruments, I would say pretty much all instruments, don't look like their first version. And they have evolved. And so there's no reason why we can continue to evolve as long as we continue having the sounds and the instruments that we want to have, But I think, like, sometimes it's important that we're like to understand we're trying to fit something that is the same for everybody into somebody that it's like everybody's different, right? So there is a likelihood that something will not work, and we will have to find adjustments for them to fit the different people that this instrument is going to, be played with by, right? So this is something that is like the more awareness that we have on, like, the instrument being the interface that we are, you know, working with, right? And that our body is the one that plays that interface, right? And so that therefore, like, there's got to be a lot of awareness on like how we are prepared or how that body is prepared to play that instrument. And sometimes I feel like we put a lot of emphasis on the instrument. Of course, we need good technique, etc. But sometimes we don't place enough emphasis on the body that will be playing that instrument, you know? So
That makes so much sense. And it's really clear. It seems sort of obvious, but it's a really elegant way of explaining it. It's sort of preparing your body to be able to deal with the realities of your instrument.
So during my conservatory times, we would rarely warm up our bodies. We would warm up the instrument for like half an hour if we could, but we would definitely disregard the physicality of it.
We've had many times on these webinars where people have talked about the repetitive work that musicians do and how and the decreasing benefit of that. You know, the pianist who works on one passage for an hour over and over and over, there's kind of diminishing returns and, in fact, damage that can occur. And we know that now, but that reflects a kind of lack of preparation, sort of mindset about how that works and lack of understanding of the physiology of that activity.
Yeah. And this is the fact, you know, sometimes we don't get told this, you know. Yeah. I certainly was not told what happens in the body in order to play the flute, you know, and I played it for quite a few years. And so, you know, then does this get passed onto then the next generation, which will be the teachers, right? And so at what point do we start, you know, bringing that information so we can empower, right? Because it's empowering, right? So that we can then have more knowledge, of course. And
great. Well, we've reached the point where I think we need to move on. Could you actually, Isabel, could you put your contact information back up just in case people want to, your
somebody wants
enough to opt. If someone wants some detail from this or the like, please you've been generous enough to offer that, so folks be in contact with her. And so I'm going to bring us to a close here. So to our listeners, I hope you've enjoyed this College Music Society webinar and that you found it professionally informative. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback about this series and our format. I hope you'll return for future webinars and online presentations from the College Music Society. Our next cultural inclusion workshop is scheduled for Sunday, May 22nd. We also anticipate a career-oriented webinar in midsummer, and we're looking forward to announcing our series for the next academic year. I noted one question in the chat related to archived webinars from this spring. I believe they are on our website, but I will double check that to make sure, because we've had at least three here in the spring prior to this one, and they should be on our site. I'll make sure that they're placed there in the CMS library. So now, on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Isabel Artigues for her presentation and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weeks. Summer will be here soon.